Hi everyone, this is your grade 6 history chapter 10 new empires and kingdoms video 1. Yes, Prashatis and what they tell us. Samudragupta, a famous ruler of a dynasty known as the Guptas. We know about Samudragupta from a long inscription inscribed on the Ashokan pillar at Allahabad. It was composed as a Kavya by Harishane, who was a poet and minister at the court of Samudragupta. This inscription is of special kind known as Prashati, a Sanskrit word. The meaning is in praise of. While Prashatis were composed for some of the rulers that you have read in chapter 9, okay, such as Gautamipura, Sri Shatakarni, they became far more important from the time of Guptas. Samudragupta's Prashati. Let us see what Samudragupta's Prashati tells us. The poet praised the king in glowing terms as a warrior, as a king who won victories in battle, who was learned and the best of poets. He is also described as equal to the gods. The Prashati was composed in very long sentences. Yes. If you look at map 7, which is in page number 105 in your history content book, you will notice an area shaded in green. You will also find a series of red dots along the east coast, and you will find areas marked in purple and blue as well. This map is based on the information provided in Prashati. Harishena describes four different kinds of rulers. The rulers of Aryavarta, the rulers of Dakshinapatha, the inner circle of neighboring states including Assam, Coast Bengal, Nepal and number of Ganashangas, and the rulers of outlying areas. In the rulers of Aryavarta, the area shaded in green on the map. Okay. The ruler of Dakshinapatha, here there were 12 rulers, some of whose capitals are marked with red dots on the map. The inner circles of neighboring states include Assam, coastal Bengal, Nepal and a number of Ganasanghas, which we have read in chapter 6 in the northwest, marked in purple on the map. The rulers of the outlying areas marked in blue on the map. And Samudragupta's mother, Kumara Devi, you are going to learn about his family. Yes, most Prashatis also mention the ancestors of the rulers. This one mentions Samudragupta's great-grandfather, father and mother. His mother, Kumara Devi, belonged to the Lichhavi Gana, while his father, Chandragupta, was the first ruler of the Gupta dynasty to adopt the grand title of Maharaj Adhiraja, a title that Samudragupta also used. His great-grandfather and grandfather are mentioned simply as Maharajas. It seems as if the family gradually rose to importance. Okay, Samudragupta in turn figures in the genealogies, a list of ancestors of later rulers of the dynasty such as his son Chandragupta too. We know about him from the inscriptions and coins. He led an expedition to western India, where he overcame the last of Shakas. According to the later belief, his court was full of learned people, including Kalidasa the poet and Aryabhatta the astronomer. And Harshavardhana and Harshasharita. While we can learn about the Gupta rulers from the inscription and coins, we can find about some kings from biographics. Harshavardhana, who ruled nearly 1400 years ago, was one such a ruler. His court poet Banabhatta wrote his biography, the Harshasharita, in Sanskrit. This gives us the genealogy of Harsha and ends with his becoming king, Xuanzang, about whom you read in chapter 9. Also spent a lot of time in Harsha's court and left a detailed account of what he saw in his court. Okay. Harsha was not the eldest son of his father, but became king of Taneshir after both his father and elder brother died. His brother-in-law was the ruler of Kanauj, which you have seen in map 7. And he was killed by the ruler of Bengal. Harsha took over the kingdom of Kanauj and then led an army against the ruler of Bengal. Although he was successful in the east and conquered both Magadha and Bengal, he was not as successful elsewhere. He tried to cross the Narmada to march into the Deccan, but was stopped by a ruler belonging to the Chalukya dynasty. Pulakeshin 2. And Pallavas, Chalukyas and Pulakeshin's Prashati. The Pallavas and Chalukyas were the most important ruling dynasty in South India during this period. The kingdom of the Pallavas spread from the region around their capital Kanchipuram to the Kaveri Delta, while that of the Chalukyas was centered around the Raichur, though between the rivers Krishna and Tungabhadra. Okay. The capital of Chalukyas, Ehol, was an important trading center. It developed as a religious center with a number of temples. The Pallavas and Chalukyas frequently raided one another's lands, especially attacking the capital cities. The best known Chalukya ruler was Pulakeshin II. We know about him from a Prashati composed by his court poet Ravakirti. This tells us about the ancestors who are traced back through 4 generations from father to son. How were these kingdoms administered? As in case of earlier kings, land revenue remained important for the rulers and the village remained the basic unit of administration. There were some new developments as well. Kings adopted a number of steps to win the support of men who were very powerful, either economically, socially, or because of their political and military strength. Some important administrative posts were known hereditary. This means that sons succeeded fathers to this post. For example, the poet Harishana was a Mahadandanayaka, or chief judicial officer like his father. Sometimes one person held many offices. For instance, besides being Mahadandanayaka, Harishana was a Kumaramatya, meaning an important minister. Okay. And these policies were reasonably effective, but sooner or later, some of these powerful men grew strong enough to set up an independent kingdom, a new kind of army. Like early rulers, some of these kings maintained a well-organized army with elephant chariots, cavalry, and foot soldiers. Besides, there were military leaders who provided the king with the troops whenever he needed them. They were not paid regular salaries. Instead, some of them received grants of land. They collected revenue from the land and used this to maintain soldiers and horses and provide equipment for warfare. These men were known as Samantas. Whenever the ruler was weak, Samantas tried to become independent. Assemblies in the Southern Kingdom. The inscription of the Pallavas mentioned a number of local assemblies. These included the Sabha, which was an assembly of Brahmin landowners. This assembly functioned through subcommittees which looked after irrigation, agriculture operations, making roads, and so on. Okay. And ordinary people in the kingdom. We can catch an occasional glimpse of the lives of ordinary people from the plays and other accounts. Kalidasa, known for his plays depicting life from the king's court. An interesting feature about these plays is that the king and the Brahmins are shown as speaking Sanskrit, while women and men and other king will be speaking Prakrit. His most famous play, Abhijnana Sakuntalam, is the story of the love between a king named Dushyanta and a young woman named Shakuntala. We find an interesting description of the plight of a poor fisherman in this play. The Chinese pilgrim Fazian noticed the plight of those who were treated as untouchables by the high and mighty. They were expected to live on the outskirts of the city. He writes, "If such a man enters a town or a marketplace, he strikes a piece of wood in order to keep himself separate people, hearing the sound. No. What it means and avoid touching him or brushing against him." And Banamatha provides us with a vivid picture of the king's army on the move, which is in page number 111. Yes, the king travelled with an enormous amount of equipment. Apart from weapons, there were things of daily use of pots, pans, furniture, golden footstools, food including animals such as goat, deer, rabbits, vegetables, spices carried on cords and loaded onto pack animals such as camels and elephants. Villages had to provide hospitality along the way. They came with the gifts of curds, gur and flowers and provided food for the animals. They also tried to meet the king and place their complaints and petitions before him. So in this move, you can learn about the king's army, which is in page number 111. So based on this video, children, there are few questions. First one, who was Harishana? Map work, you have to complete the map work in an India outline. Mark the important cities and kingdom. For this, you have to refer page number 105 and you have to paste it in classwork page. Okay. Which dynasties were the important ruling dynasties in South India during this period? Why did they collect revenue? Fifth one, who was Kalidasa? For this question, you can refer page number 110 in your history book. Thanks for watching the video. Keep watching.